Hello, CUBE community. Welcome back. This is Jackie McGuire. I'm the Principal Analyst and Practice Lead for Security at theCUBE, and we are live from RSAC 2025. I am joined today by Mike Nichols. He is from Elastic. Thank you for joining us today, Mike.
Thanks for having me today.
We were just commiserating that we are both a little bit draggy halfway through
we
day two.
We are draggy on day two, yeah.
But I think it's almost time for happy hours.
Coffee's so out of reach, but I'm going to see if I can channel it. So.
Yeah, I already warned everybody that I just cracked open a 30-ounce cold brew, and I'll probably be levitating within a couple minutes. But yeah, so tell me about your RSAC experience so far. What sights have you seen? What things surprised you?
Well, it is good to see. I was seeing when we first came over here that I feel like the attendance is starting to pick back up after like sort of the pre-COVID dip of levels where it was sort of hybrid. Get a lot more excitement now, a lot more people. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's a booth out there that doesn't say agentic AI on it somewhere.
Are they people or are they machines?
Yeah, who knows, who knows. But it is good to see the excitement back in the industry, at least the amount of people that are here.
Yeah. I am almost wondering if more companies paid for people to come to RSA because there's this huge new wave of everything that security teams are like, we're only half involved in most of these projects, but we still are responsible for them.
Yeah. Well, like cloud security, right? You know, does it live in IT? Does it live with the CISO? Who knows anymore?
Yeah. It's one of the interesting things about the cloud is it made it very easy to spin things up, but when it's very easy to spin things up, it's also easy to do it without security finding out about it, right?
Yeah, agile development led to a visibility gap, I'll say, in some of these ways.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things that we wanted to talk about, which I think is really interesting, is one of the crazy statistics that has been floating around in security for the last few years is that 40% of SIEM standups fail, which is an astronomical number. And I don't think it's because the SIEMs don't work. I usually think it's either that a customer doesn't properly deploy them, can't get the data onboarded, pick the wrong one for their needs. But you guys are helping kind of clean up the mess after that happens, and you have this new thing called automatic migration, which actually helps you move from the SIEM that's falling down to Elastic, right?
Yeah, it's actually an interesting point. I think, you know, from doing a lot of software, different business for a long time, I always say to people the first thing is, you know, probably invest in your process first, not before you go buy a piece of tech. Probably what you have already could work. Maybe it's blasphemous to hear a product person say that from a vendor or a software vendor, but. Yeah, it's a lot of times the processes. I was a former analyst in a former life, and I remember, you know, just being able to, you know, being training your team on how to use the products, giving them the time and the space to actually use them properly. It makes a big difference. And what we see in SIEM handovers or turnovers, right? Because the market had a few news stories last year on the SIEM market in general changing. And so these people who have decided to make a switch, I think there's an under appreciation of the level of time it takes to move both the content, but then also the learnings and the team's education over. So we can't do everything through automation, but one thing we found a really great way to help with is the content side. There's a few different layers of it. There's, you know, bringing data in is always hard. So a while ago we launched something called automatic import, which maps your data to the data, you know, the schemas you need to actually make it useful. But then the next problem, as you were talking about, is people usually have a pretty entrenched set of either hunting queries or rules, and they want to at least get a one-for-one. They want to know that what I used to have, I'm covered over here before they make net new things. Mm-hmm. And that used to be a very intensive process from services, time, dollars, or maybe just didn't get done at all. So this whole feature we launched called automatic migration, the point is to leverage things like large language models with the context that we offer in Elastic by having a underlying vector store and using retrieval augmented generation for context, mm-hmm. to take what you have and then basically give you what it would be equivalent to in Elastic. But the biggest piece of it, Elastic being sort of an open source company and being very, like, I think, transparent, it was to show your work side. It actually explains to you why it does what it does and helps to give you that confidence that it's making the right switches.
Yeah, remove the black box effect.
Yeah, exactly. This is we were joking earlier about UEBA, like any, you know, in the early days of machine learning and now in AI. Anyone who says it's proprietary or I can't tell you the secrets, you can't trust that. You can't understand what's actually happening.
So. It's almost astounding to me the level of professional who would refer to AI as a black box. I saw one of the heads of AI at one of the big four consulting firms was like, well, we really don't know how these things work. And I was like, you can absolutely build enough logging into an LLM to see every step along the way. It's going to create a like 5-gig log.
But right. Well, but yeah. You know, and the benefit, I think, because AI is also, you know, ramping up astronomically in the non-security space, mm-hmm. we get the benefits of that. So like as when ChatGPT adds, you know, very good ability to say, show your work in there, you can actually now, if you go online, ask a question, hey, how did you figure this out? It gives you all the links. Mm-hmm. That sort of ethos now trickles into security as well. So we get all that kind of underlying citations as a benefit of the fact that it's being used in other places.
Yeah, and I think you really nailed with the transparency. I was just talking to Mike Arrowsmith from Ninja One and talking about how in security, trust is the number one currency you have.
Exactly.
And authenticity and transparency are the straightest line to trust. So having a product that does what you say it does and shows you how it's doing it and you can trust it, I think. And for security teams who are already really leery of anything involving AI, one, because I think they're only being involved in a small number of things before they've actually hit servers.
Yes, yeah, they're coming in late, unfortunately, to the party.
Yeah. Yeah, I saw 20% was how many projects have security involved during POC, which is insane.
And now, I mean, how many products do you use daily that have started to embed AI but not tell you? Now it's like deep in the release notes. Who knows, you know, whether it's your documentations, if you use any online document services, right? You're using your email. You notice now there's a little AI logo and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Has your security team and your risk team actually gone through and approved those? Do they understand what's happening? So it's just getting thrown into everything we use today.
Yeah, so I want to go back to something you said about, you know, look at your processes first.
Yeah.
And I think I could not emphasize that more, and that I think a lot of enterprises end up spending time researching Band-Aids and buying Band-Aids and applying Band-Aids, not really teaching their employees not to run with scissors. I think we could probably do a lot better if we focused on. So you guys had sent me a study by, I think, Mimecast that said, I'm going to read this statistic, that human error is the leading cause of 95% of security breaches. And I think we like to think that most security breaches are like super sophisticated hackers getting in through zero-day exploits and traversing our network through all these, and it's not. It's not. So what does the 95% look like?
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I mean, you're right about the fact that we all like to focus on the really funds, maybe a morbid way to put it, but you know, the really sophisticated nation state attacks that do really interesting things, that's where we want to spend our time and that's what makes the news. But it's the boring stuff, it's the day-to-day stuff, it's credential reuse, and you know, it's misconfigurations of systems. We mentioned it a little bit earlier before we started about cloud, you know, just sort of having a new way for developers to spin up fast, but forgetting to do underlying, you know, compliance controls.
Mm-hmm.
It's super boring, and it's that bottom of the pyramid, but there's a reason why they're the top controls in CIS that's recommended. And we don't spend enough time kind of thinking about those or focused on those things. And I think a lot of human error also gets incurred when our analysts, who are already underwater, have to solve these problems by pivoting between 15 different systems. It's the same as it was, and I was an analyst, I don't want to say how many years ago, but many, many years ago, it was the same thing. You're copying and pasting, you know, IOCs. There's no easy way to stitch things together. You make you misclick or mistype something, and then that leads to a problem in the future, down the road. So I just think the automation that I like to see are ones that remove a lot of that annoyance away, but still let the human in the loop, that decision expert that knows your business, knows the mission, mm-hmm. can make all the smart analytical decisions and not be bogged down by, you know, these sort of mundane tasks of data collection and duplication, things like that.
Yeah, and I love the idea of having kind of an intelligent assistant to help you with SIM migration, because that is one of the points. You know, I worked at Cribble for a couple years, and we helped with a lot of SIM migration.
Yeah.
And it not only is it a huge lift at the organization, but it also is the one time that you introduce a lot of risk.
Yes.
Because if you're going from one SIM to another, and you've got two sets of alerts happening, and you're cutting data sources over one by one, there can be a lot of confusion around who's still responsible for what. So tell me a little bit more about how automatic migration helps assess that. So it tells you what it's doing, but does it help assess that kind of human error of like, nobody's covering this data source anymore?
That's a great question. And yes, I think back to your key point of like, no matter what products we sell in security, ultimately the whole thing we're doing is reducing risk, to your point. And so that doesn't come without transparency. I wear a lot of wounds from previous years. And I remember when I was an IDS analyst years ago, and we switched to a different IDS, obviously it was an executive top-down switch. Mm-hmm. And similarly, I said, well, I need to make sure I have this coverage. And they said, oh yeah, you do, here's the rules. But all they gave me access to was the rule name. And it was like, you know, preventing exploit 1-3. Well, here's our exploit 1-3 prevention. I said, well, I need to see the code. Like, how do you do this? Because I need, if I'm going to tell my boss and ultimately up the chain that we've like solved this problem, I need to trust that it's happening. And it was one of those, we can't tell you.
Compliance versus security.
Exactly.
We checked the box. Don't worry about it.
So the first piece of migration is what you mentioned earlier, the transparency of explaining exactly what's happening in a human language. Hey, we did this. We moved this. This is why we chose this. There's also a layer of semantic reasoning involved where if we have a rule that already exists, we're not going to make a new one. We'll say, hey, we actually selected this rule that we have for this rule, and here's why. And if you don't agree, you can change it. So that's sort of the first tier level is you as an analyst, whoever's making this migration decision can say, I agree with this, trust, and there's a little dashboard, you know, green stuff that's done, yellow stuff that needs some work, right? To your second point, there's sort of two layers of that that are not what we call in the attack migration, automatic migration feature set, but part of what we deliver. One we have is called data quality, where we are automatically running analysis of the data coming in. Because the other big problem if you're an analyst is it's only as good as the data you get. And if you're relying on a system to send you information, as you were mentioning earlier, like some kind of forwarding system or ETL processor, and the data drops for some reason, you don't know about it, or if the vendor you got the data from changes their fields in some new update and now you don't have what you need. So we do that identification as well of, hey, all of a sudden these things you required are missing. And the last piece you mentioned is a really interesting one we are dabbling in, haven't gotten all the way there yet, which is looking at all your data and saying, hey, you should be doing these other things because you could, that, you know, from what's available in your information, especially as people create these massive new, you know, data lake, data ocean, data swamp, whatever you want to call it, they're creating a big place of data.
I always call it the data swamp.
Yeah, and so what can I do with it, right? What's available? And it is able to kind of one-to-one map you into that. So that's, we try to help with all those different layers because ultimately if the data isn't any good, then nothing works after that. Or you get that false negative or false sense of security where you feel like everything's working well because you don't have alerts. Well, there's no alerts because the data has dropped 3 days ago and nobody noticed, right?
Yeah, and I think a lot of security teams are really overwhelmed and they want to be able to use AI, but to your point, you can only be as intelligent as your data is.
Yes.
And identification, classification, it's always been a problem. And you know, and it's something that when the first talk I wrote, I think at Cribble was called Security is a Data Problem, because it's we've got all this data, but to your point, a lot of it's in swamps, a lot of it is raw logs that we haven't processed in any way. And so being able to get a hold of your data, get it in one place, figure out what's in it, I don't really think we can even start having a conversation about AI capabilities until you've kind of, one, gotten into a SIM that is effective. We all know that there's a lot of legacy software hanging around, and address the data issue. So do you foresee that as we kind of build better quality data, kind of get more buy-in, that security teams will be less skeptical and embrace AI more to help them do the jobs?
Well, less skeptical, probably not. I think we're a skeptical bunch
we're
by design.
Built that way.
But I do think, I hope we get to improve. And I think a couple ways. One, a big one that we're trying to help people with is a lot of companies are making architectural decisions or have made them based on prior knowledge. And so, you know, they think of SIEMs as a monolithic duplication of data. And right now there could be massive sovereignty issues. Maybe I don't want my data to reside in a certain country, or privacy regulations. So they make decisions on how their SOC teams are organized and even how their data is going to be organized based on those. You know, we're at a place now where we can do federated or distributed searching far easier. So you can actually keep data locally in different locations, different cloud providers, not pay those tremendous export costs that come from coming in our cloud systems. So that's sort of step one, is like actually stitching together a distributed view of your data without having to duplicate it all to one place. And I think that already provides people a sense of relief of, oh wait, I can actually answer the question.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's great. That's sort of step one of this reduction of the skepticism that is an analyst. But the second one I think is when you talk about the real what AI really is under the hood. And you know, in Elastic we've chosen to really rely on, I mentioned earlier, but what, you know, RAG, retrieval augmented generation, because there's different ways to go about it. You'll see some vendors here that are sort of tuning models and delivering them to you and they brand them a certain way, or you know, the challenge always is it out of date? Does it have my information?
RAG allows you to retrieve more current, updated information and ensures that you're handling that side of it and the customer doesn't have to?
So to the skepticism part, what sometimes happens in these like butt-in-a-box systems, you'll say, hey, how do I fix this? And you get this amazing knowledge that comes from this giant hyperscaler's LLM that is right, but it doesn't have your information of like, by the way, this is a really big deal, you know, call, you know, Joe over here first before you do anything else. Being able to add that context simply by putting into in a knowledge base and being able to, hey, always check here first.
Mm-hmm.
Then when the assistant tells you, hey, here's the greatest answer, also, by the way, know these things, I think that starts to alleviate some of that skepticism as well. They don't have to also check their wiki or whatever other systems they have to you know, validate what the model gave them is accurate. It actually has the information from their own systems in the answer, citations to where they can find information. Again, the show your work part.
Yeah.
You know, explain to me how you got this answer and why it's relevant to my needs.
Yeah, so I imagine a lot of people at RSA will want to come see you showing your work so they can find you on the show floor.
We are, we're in the North Hall. Okay. Come towards the back. If you go where the food is or the restrooms, either one, we're right there.
I mean, that's perfect.
Look for me, I'll be there. Now, big Elastic signs, you can't miss us. But definitely, you can come and see the migration at work, or even just in general. I think, you know, talk more about the ethos. We're really trying to push for many years now in security in general, the idea of, you know, open sourcing more things. We put all of our detections, all of our models, everything out in the open.
Yeah.
You know, the whole idea of more eyes on this is better. You know, don't get rid of the closed source black box ethos that was security. That doesn't help any of us except for the vendors.
Well, I always say, like, art of war, right? If you have to think like your adversaries, I have yet to see a licensed malware product. You know, they're open sourcing, they're sharing information, they're creating pools of knowledge for bad, but we should also be doing that for good. We're not going to beat a giant volunteer army with very specialized sentry soldiers.
Incentives targeting us. Yeah, I mean, how many people wrote the same log4j rules the day after that? You know, it is the idea of, you know, the rising tide lifts all boats. The more we can democratize this, the more we can share information, I think the better we all are. Mm-hmm. And I hope we are a voice of good in that idea of pushing the open source ethos that is there. So
awesome. Well, yeah. Mike, thank you so much for joining us. I am looking forward to coming by the booth, and I want to see your migrations and progress.
I want to
see
it.
You doing the work. Really appreciate having you on. Any after hours or special events people should be aware of?
We have an event tomorrow. I think you got to come to the booth and get the actual information. I won't, you know, so you can see where it is. But we are doing an event tomorrow night. You know, like everybody else, there'll be alcohol or non-alcohol, depending on what you're into, plus some music and some dancing, maybe? I don't know.
I am always into dancing. All right, so stop by the Elastic booth for food, a bathroom break, and an invitation
and
for some dancing.
And we have these little cool Lego things you can build, like the minifigs you can make if you want those too. So, yeah, all kinds of fun stuff.
Your booth number is N5778, in case anybody was wondering.
Wow, I would not
remember
that.
My team and my ear is on it.
Thank you.
Awesome. Well, thanks for joining us, Mike. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
For theCUBE, live at RSAC 2025, I'm Jackie McGuire. We'll be back shortly with more high-frequency insights and information. Thanks, everybody.